I was born in Elmira, New York, which is on the southern boundary between New York and Pennsylvania, about halfway across the state, about 140 miles from New York City.
Yeah. Was it a rural kind of upbringing or a town upbringing?
It was a town at that time of about 40,000 people, a kind of a prosperous little manufacturing community, oddly enough. This is right up to the Depression. We had probably 9 or 10 pretty healthy little businesses. One of them was American LaFrance Fire Engine Company. Another one was Kennedy Valve Company. It made fire hydrants. And those were typical of the industries that were in the town. It was a nice, stable base of employment.
How big was your family?
I had one brother, and that's it, my mother and father.
Did the Depression affect your family?
Very much. My father was in the brokerage business, stock brokers, and the volume of business just dropped precipitously, so up about 1935 or so.
What was it like being a kid in that era? I mean, what did you do for fun?
I think it was a wonderful place to grow up. We lived on a place that had 6 acres around our house. We had a river behind us. I had a canoe. We used to go swimming there. It was right on the edge of a farming area, and we used to go hunting and fishing and hiking all the time. It was a wonderful place to grow up.
It sounds like a marvelous outdoor childhood. Uh-huh. You know, when you walk into a classroom full of kids, you have the full spectrum of personalities, the quiet kid, the smart kid, the joker kid. If we walked into your elementary school classroom, which kid were you?
Oh, that's kind of hard to say. I did pretty well in school, and I enjoyed it very much. I was probably in the top 10% or 5% of the class.
When you look back on your childhood, even though it was the Depression, it was hard times, did you like your childhood?
Oh, yes, I think I'm right.
Why was that?
Well, I think living where we did and being out of doors much contributed a lot. I was never bored. I could only walk out the door and do something. And I was active in the YMCA and the Boy Scouts and things like that. So I never thought much about, you know, about the problems of society later on.
What was your situation when Pearl Harbor was bombed?
I was trying to go to school at the University of Pennsylvania. I worked part-time and went to school part-time. And that's something, of course, you knew at that point in time that the war was going to come along and get you one way or another. I was probably 18 or 19 then, and I mean, everybody had that feeling of inevitability. And didn't worry anybody too much. I was in the job I had in the summertime. I was a cost accountant, and they were starting to draft people out of the workforce. And it seemed to me that every time they took someone, I got the job. And it was harder and harder to keep up with the work. I worked 6 days a week then.
Well, describe then the process under which you got into the Army Air Corps.
Well, I'd always had an inclination to fly. That's another thing about growing up in Elmira, New York. It was the home base of the soaring activity in the United States. So I'd always had kind of an interest in airplanes, and I'd had a couple of flights in airplanes along the way with my father. But at the time, they had a limitation of 2 years college to get in the Navy or the Army Air Corps, and which I didn't have at the time. And I'll never forget, after Pearl Harbor, my friend who was in the Naval ROTC, a little bit older than I was, and he was pretty sure that we were going to have to go. And both of us decided it'd probably be nicer to join the Navy Air Corps, a little classier outfit. Well, that didn't happen. Then one day he walked in, he said, the Army has come out with a test now. It's the equivalent of 2 years college or your proficiency. Good enough, you pass this, they'll take you in the aviation cadets. Let's take it. So down we go and take the test. Now, I did pretty well on it. And about 2 weeks later, the Navy came out with one, so the two of us were kicking the sides of the wall over that, but the die was cast. So we just sat around for a while. This was probably very early January, and about the middle of February, the Army came along and they swore us all into the Army so they could keep us. And then they put us on a payroll, and we never got a check. But we stayed there until we were called up in about the 1st of May of that year. And then they shipped us off to Maxwell Field, Alabama, and we started the cadet training process from there.
Well, take us through the training process of how they basically turn a college kid, into a navigator.
Looking back, I think the Army had a marvelous educational system. But I'll say one thing, they had a good group of people to work on. The average kid or person my age was, I think, fairly well educated, had a good secondary education and was educatable to a much better degree than people may be today. So it was well planned, and you never had much time to question what they were doing to you. It was just on to the next thing at that point.
Well, take us through the training process then. How did you become a navigator then?
Well, in the classification process, they rate your abilities as to what you would prefer and which you're more adaptable to, and that psychological test pretty much determined that. Now, if some fellows who won a fast commission would try to be a bombardier, in those days, about 90 days, you could be a bombardier. And a pilot training took almost a year, and navigation training took probably 9 months or so.
What do you remember about the training process?
Well, I'd say it was all pretty orderly. At the level of education that I had, it wasn't any great problem for me to learn to do what they wanted to have you do. Yeah.
Was there a point where you sort of graduated as a navigator?
Yeah, you got a commission and you graduated as a navigator. And at that point on, then they assigned you to assignment points, say, where they were forming bomber crews. I was sent to Gowan Field in Boise, Idaho, and then I guess through a lottery process wound up on a crew.
Excuse me. Did you know what kind of aircraft you were going to end up on?
No.
Well, talk about after you received your commission, you've been trained as a navigator. Did you get together with a crew at that point?
Yeah, we were assigned to a crew at that point. I was the last man to be placed on the crew. When I got to the crew, the navigator was all they lacked. They had a pilot and a co-pilot. They had the bombardiers and the gunners and the radio operators and all that in place. And they'd been together maybe 3-4 weeks ahead of me. So.
And at that point, you knew you were going to be on B-24s?
No. We were at Gowan Field, and that was an assignment point for the crews. But they put us on a B-24 crew. Now, at that moment, I didn't know that the pilot had been put through B-24 training, so that pretty much crystallized us. And at the time, there were probably more 24s available to use a training aircraft than there were 17s.
What was it like when the crew got together? You had all these personalities from different places coming in. Did the crew coalesce pretty well?
I'd say so, yeah. Everyone had pretty much had an idea of what he had to do or wanted to do. And there was constant flying and training from that point on.
When you look back at that crew, When you look back on that crew training period, did anything unusual happen? What sticks in your mind about that period of time?
Well, it was kind of a shakedown cruise, and oddly enough, we got rid of the co-pilot, who was a little less than competent, frankly, and the radio operator that we were assigned wasn't very good, so we got rid of him. So, but that those two replacements, I think, reinforced the confidence we all had among ourselves.
Yeah, were you conscious of the fact you were all going to be dependent on each other in a combat situation?
I don't know so much in a combat, but the thing that you grabbed quickly in order to make that airplane run right, you had to do what your job was and do it pretty well.
What did you think the first time you flew in a B-24?
Well, I didn't think it was such a nice airplane, to tell you the truth. I think I'd had a vision of B-17s or something in my mind. Those, you have to understand, they were old model airplanes, and the B-24 was not anybody's favorite airplane, I don't believe.
Why was that?
Well, it just didn't run like an airplane did. The airplane was not a beautiful thing to look at. It had none of the symmetry of a 17 or something like that. It was uncomfortable, by and large, particularly at higher altitudes when things got cold. It just never generated the affection for the airplane. Later on, an improved version of it took away a lot of the things that we had to complain about. But it was, we were, later on, as we were converted over to B-17s, I think we were all quite happy that we made it.
During the training process, were there any mishaps, accidents, problems that you saw?
No, not among ourselves. We had a couple of fatal crashes, and a tow target airplane crashed on the base. That was about it. You sort of began to realize that with all this flying, somebody was going to get hurt at some point. No one cried over it very much.
Yeah. Sounds like a funny question, but did you like the flying part of it?
Yeah, very much.
How did you get over to Europe?
We flew over. We were in a newly formed bomb group and given all new airplanes. We trained at Davis-Monthan Field here in Tucson, and we flew the whole gang over lock, stock, and barrel to our base in England.
What was the route to get over there?
The route that we took, of course, it was in the wintertime, it was at the beginning of February, so we flew from Tucson down to a staging place in Kansas for a few days to get final equipment and things like that. And then we flew to West Palm Beach, Florida to Morrison Field and flew from there to Puerto Rico, to Atchison in British Guiana, to Belém in Brazil. And then we hopped the South Atlantic to Dakar, in Africa and up the African coast to Marrakesh. And from Marrakesh, we flew on up to England, landing in Wales on the way up there.
That's such a long journey. Did you feel any pressure as the navigator to get where you had to go?
Oh, yeah. It was the first experience we had with serious navigation. You know, we were flying oceans and flying at the edge of hostile territory, and it's a case going up from Europe, yeah. You were aware of the fact you could lose your airplane if something happened to you.
Were you actually in a group going over, or were you single aircraft?
Single aircraft. They'd schedule a takeoff, maybe one airplane at night every 15 minutes or something like that. But you were never in sight of one another. In fact, I don't remember even talking to any of the other airplanes.
You know, that's such a long journey in so many different locations. Mm-hmm. What sticks in your mind when you remember that journey so many years ago?
Oh, I think it's probably the interest from a navigation standpoint, thinking of all the parts of the world that you were seeing on the way over.
Did it strike you as, you know, you were kind of a college kid and now the world is opening up?
Oh, I don't know why I thought so much about that. The only, I say, serious thought I had, I remember when we went from Marrakech to go up to Wales, which is our point, we passed Lisbon in the night, and you could see the lights of Lisbon. And I thought to myself, well, that's the last bunch of lights you're going to see for a long time. And then outside of that, we got up to a place called Valley, Wales, landed there, and then flew over to our base in a couple of days where we were stationed in England.
What was the name of the base you were stationed at?
Sudbury. They just had numbers. 174 was the number of the base.
And which group were you with?
We were in the 486 bombardment group.
Do you remember what your impression was of the base when you got over there?
No, I thought it was pretty, it was completely finished. We straggled in there probably over a period of 2.5-3 weeks until we got the whole place together. But I thought it was pretty well organized on the start-up, and learned later, of course, that these bases had been built in many cases almost a year in advance in anticipation of the 8th Air Force staffing them, which impressed me a little bit. And it didn't all just happen.
Do you know approximately when you landed there, when you arrived, what month and year?
Well, it would have been in March of 1944. I don't think I could come up with a date. Mm. Maybe the 15th of the month, something like that.
Was there any training that continued even after you arrived over there?
Well, yes. The two things that they emphasized to us is, number one, that it was very easy to get lost flying around England in almost a flash of an eyelash. You could get lost as a navigator, or you wouldn't know where the heck you were, all looked alike, and you couldn't fly out in the ocean, and you had to stay away from London. They had all these constraints on you. So that made a quick impression on us. We did a little bit of navigational training and formation training. It was really our first introduction into formalized military formation flying, because that was the name of the game over there in England, but it was formation flying and bombing, of course.
How many missions did you fly in a B-24?
12.
And of those 12 missions, were there any missions that stood out in your mind for one reason or another?
Well, I should say my experience with the first mission we ever flew was probably one of the worst. To digress a second, there was a gentleman named Bernie Lay who wrote a book called I Wanted Wings, and he was the commander of the second group in our wing. And we had one experience in a trial mission with him, and he didn't perform very well as a leader. And going over the first mission we flew, he wasn't on course crossing the English Channel. His group drew some fire from Caen, and it was apparent to us pretty soon that he was off course. Now, this is the first mission. We had a so-called command pilot there, and you didn't know whether you should impose your judgment on this guy, tell him he's crazy, give up leading, quit, or something. But we kept moving ourselves over as best we could to stay away from where he was going, which was over a German airfield at an altitude of 12,000 feet. We knew what anti-aircraft fire was, but it was kind of a theoretical thing. But we didn't realize at a lower altitude like that, the field of fire of that thing had intensified tremendously. It was like being out on the edges of a mushroom. And he led his group over, and in an instant, three planes were shot down, and the rest of his group started to scatter. So there wasn't much air discipline, say, among a new bunch like that. So we flew over the field and went on to near Lyon, France, and reformed. And then the decision was made, well, we better go back home because we had lost a number of their planes, and some were with us, and some of them just went home. So we went home. But in the process of that, in the B-24, we carried two navigators, one in the nose turret, and the nose turret navigator was hit in the head with a burst of flak. So we got our introduction pretty fast to blood and combat, and we had a fire in the waste oxygen regulator, and we had a hole in one of the engines. And when we didn't know until we got back, but the nose wheel tire on the airplane was shot flat, so when we landed, we had a rude awakening on that. So that was our introduction to combat.
And where were you in the plane on that mission?
In that mission, oddly enough, it was not our own airplane, and they had modified this airplane to put the navigational facility on the flight deck, which brought you away from the bomb sight and the nose and all this. I don't think I would have had the problems that I had I been in my own place down below in that nose of that airplane, but it was too late to change. When we got back on the ground, that thing got changed pretty doggone fast.
So was that the only mission you flew on the flight deck?
Yeah. Yes, sir.
Do you remember what you thought after that mission? Like, was it really dawning on you the seriousness of the situation you were in?
Oh, yeah. You began to realize that was everyday way of life, but you also began to realize it was a mistake, and if things had gone right, they wouldn't have gone the way they did.
That's certainly a memorable mission, your first mission. Did you have any sense of, I wonder if they're all like this?
No, because the first thing you realize this was screwed up. It wasn't. But what you did realize, though, was how formidable it was when somebody started to shoot at you.
For people who don't know what flak's like, what's flak like?
It's just ordinary shell fire exploding, usually on you or close to you. And I think we weren't so enchanted with the flak as we were getting out of that damn situation and getting away from it. But after then you begin to realize this was pretty tough stuff. And you made sure that any future missions you flew, you weren't flying into flak areas unless you absolutely had to get into them.
Were there other missions, for one reason or another, that stand out in your mind in the other 11 missions you flew in the 24?
Oh, oddly enough, the one I was most memorable was the invasion of England, pardon me, of France. On D-Day, they called us and woke us up about 1:30 in the morning and put us up in the air about 2:30. We flew all night long in a holding pattern with a lot of other airplanes all night waiting for the time to go over to the continent. Our time on the continent was to be 6:25, and the night was beautiful and moonlit, but full of airplanes everywhere you looked. And when we got probably, 5 or 10 minutes past the English coast, a solid undercast came in and we couldn't see anything else for the whole rest of that mission. And of course we were all pretty excited in the idea, this might be Armageddon on wheels over there with these Germans. Well, it was uneventful and we just flew back, landed. But the next day we flew, and the thing that I'll never forget was the sight of that English Channel with the ships in it. You could literally walk from England to France on the ships that were in that channel that next day.
Just so I make sure I cover, does anything else stand out in your mind, or you remember those days flying in those first 12 missions, the B-24?
Oh, probably nothing in particular about it.
Were you... getting more and more confident in that kind of thing.
I think so. You got to be a professional, I think, at what you were doing. You realize, you know, stay on course, get the formation together, stay the hell out of the flak that was absolutely not necessary.
Who was your pilot?
Pilot's name was William Monroe.
Was he a good pilot? Were you confident in his
ability? Absolutely, yeah. Mm-hmm. We had an unusual crew experience. We were together for 15 months as a crew, which is quite long for any combat. So all of us got to be pretty good friends. Even after the war was over, we all visited one another and things like that. Yeah.
When you're on the plane and going to a mission, what's the mood on the plane? Is it, guys joking around, or is it solemn? Is it, you know, what's it like on the plane as you're on the way to the mission?
Well, the first thing about a mission is its reputation. You're told you're going to Paris or someplace, and instantly in everybody's mind, that's a tough place, a bad place, easy place, something like that. The weather's not bad and that sort of thing. But we were a lead crew, and the first thing you had to do was get your formation together. We'd take off and circle, and gradually our group would fall in on us until we had the entire 36 airplanes formed, and then usually either you were leading the wing or you were following it, and you had to meet with the other 36 airplanes at a time. This was absolutely very important, to meet with these people on the heading, on the time, on the altitude that was scheduled for your place in that formation. It wasn't just your two groups, it was a whole division or Air Force or something like that, wasn't it?
So everybody had to link up at the right time.
Yeah, it was very important. If you goofed up on that one, you had a lot of problems. You can't, it's like a line of buses. If you get out of the line, you can't get back in the bus for a long time.
While the plane is going on the mission, what's a navigator? What are you doing on the airplane as the navigator?
Well, you're keeping track, obviously, of where you are and where you're going, and also any conditions that are disrupting the flow of the formation for one reason or another. Bad weather, change of targets sometimes, just a lot of other things. And you sort of anticipate. It's 5 minutes to the next place, 15 minutes to the next place, 8 minutes to the next place, things like that go in your mind all the time.
And are you staying in contact with the pilot at all, letting him know you're on course, that kind of thing?
Uh-huh.
Did you say you were in the lead crew?
Yeah, we're in the lead crew.
Any extra pressure being the navigator in the lead crew?
Well, you had to make those assemblies. That was the name of the game.
Did you ever have any problems with navigator and the lead crew? Anything that was a real challenge for you that you remember?
No, I don't think so, except that first mission, I wish I knew, what I should have known then. Just being new, you didn't. We could have avoided the whole thing simply by going away from these people, but we didn't dare try. Two missions after that, I'd let that guy go on by himself forever then.
At some point you converted from the B-24 to the B-17. Can you describe what happened?
Well, of course we never knew this, but apparently we were supposed to have been a B-24, a B-17 group originally. The 8th Air Force was made up of three divisions, 1st, 2nd, and 3rd, and the 3rd was a B-17 division. They put four groups of B-24s into that division, which made no sense at all, because you flew faster than the 17s. They could fly higher. You were incomparable airplanes, so you have fight in your own war, sort of. But it would have been kind of encouraging if they told you to take it easy, guys, you'll be in B-17s in another month or so. That was really a good break.
Do you remember what your reaction was? I mean, who told you you were going to, oh, well, guys, you're going to start with in the B-17?
Well, we could hardly wait to get in there. The 24 was a, frankly, it was a miserable airplane in Europe. It didn't have the ceiling that you needed to carry the bomb load that was in it. It was a difficult airplane to fly in formation compared to a 17. And in terms of crew comfort, it was so much better for the crew than a 24 was.
Mm-hmm. Well, we're in the nose of a B-17, uh-huh. And you're sitting... Is this similar to what you had? That is to say, in the nose of a B-17, did you have a navigator's table, that mm-hmm. kind of thing?
Just as I'm sitting here, we were a little less crowded to my recollection than this thing is now.
When you're on the B-17, what equipment you would use? You know, you've got this instrument to your left there. Is that something you would have?
We had a similar type British provided instrument called a G-set, which was a radio system that would give you a simultaneous fix, but it was very easily jammed by the Germans, so its use pretty much extended only to England, maybe 20, 30 miles off the English coast. It was a much better piece of equipment than the Americans ever had. You know.
I should ask, how many missions did you fly in a B-17?
16 in a 17, 12.
And I'm kind of picturing you on a mission in a B-17. You know, you're at your table. What are you checking? Have you got a bunch of maps in front of you?
Uh-huh. Or? You have the mission plan, you have the maps, you're looking at what potential anti-aircraft areas you might have to go through or will have to go through, and also you start to think about the deployment of the bombing runs themselves. As you approach the target, the three squadrons that you were running separated out into three individual squadrons. You bomb by squadrons, so they took intervals, staggered 1, 2, 3, and then if you were in the lead, you drop the bombs. Generally speaking, everyone dropped bombs on the lead bombardier.
So they were watching that lead bombardier.
That guy was supposed to hit the target all the time.
By the way, when your group, was it just you, your crew converted to B-17, or did the whole group convert?
The whole group came over in a period of maybe 30 days. They took the whole group.
There must have been some little training period or something that you had to convert, was there?
Well, a little bit, but I think it just shows you how well the training worked in the United States Air Force. There was a little different airplane to land than a B-24 for the pilots were concerned. As far as the navigation was concerned, it was so much, just the physical facility was so much better. We were happy. We went out and probably had 8 or 10 practice bombing runs around. The site hadn't changed, the autopilot. Things were pretty much a piece of cake, and I'd say very smooth.
Did you stay as the lead crew? In the B-17, when you converted, did you stay as the lead crew?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And those missions as in the B-17, were there missions for one reason or another that stand out in your mind?
Well, the first thing that happened, of course, when we went to the 17s is practically all of our bombing was in Germany from that point on, usually pretty good distances into Germany and at higher altitude, at 26,000, 28,000 feet. One exception, we bombed Brest for a couple days in a row. The Germans were holed up there, and that was kind of a diversion. But other than that, it was all Germany.
Did you have as a navigator, did you have a gun to use?
I had a machine gun, which we're sitting in the nose of these B-17 right now. these guns were sort of add-ons and not really very effective unless somebody flew out and perched on the end of the gun, I guess.
Those are the what are called the cheek guns?
The cheek gun. Now, the installation of the nose turret, which the bombardier operated, was a significant improvement in the defensive firepower of the 17.
During a bomb run, you hit the initial point, the IP. Mm-hmm. What are you doing at that point?
Just nothing, watching the bombardier. Actually, you're making sure the bombardier sees that target as fast as it possibly can. Sometimes that's easy, sometimes it's not so easy for him to pick out a building in the city or something by the edge of a river. He has to be pretty adept at sizing up the target area under your direction. The faster you find that, the better bombing results you're going to get.
That's just part of working together real well. Mm. Did you have any missions that you lost an engine?
No. Just that first mission, we didn't actually lose that engine. It had a hole in it, but we didn't lose any engine.
Yeah. And other than the first mission, were there any other missions anybody was injured?
No.
Were there any missions you got separated from the group?
No. We would never do that. There were times we turned around. One mission I remember, we were going up probably at maybe Magdeburg, Germany, someplace like that. And when we got up about the Kiel Isthmus, there were airplanes starting to mull around up there, which showed you that they didn't like the weather ahead, and there was kind of confusion. We decided just simply to pull out of that and go back home, and which was a wise decision. You don't get anywhere just flying around burning gasoline wondering what to do.
Were there missions that you came under fighter attack?
Yeah.
What do you remember about that?
Not too much. It's happened so fast. You're doing your job, and your job isn't a gunner. You're not a gunner, really. You're up there to do other things. And the action is so fast and so sporadic. You know, here he is, there he goes, or something like that. And I would say I didn't think these guns were any particular comfort in the front end of it. So you realize, though, that when those your own guns started to fire, that it was real trouble. Those guys could do you a lot of damage. The fellows didn't shoot their guns off just for the heck of it.
What do you think was maybe your most difficult mission as a navigator?
Oh gosh, I don't know. I would say when we flew to Magdeburg, Germany, where one group got out of position in forming the bomber stream, and it didn't do anything much to us, but wondering all the time what was going to happen to these guys or where the hell they were going to go all the way up was just a real puzzle. And eventually what they did is they went to a higher altitude and flew across the bomber stream to drop their bombs. And after that, I don't know where the heck they dropped in after the bombing. It was, you know, you just wonder what the heck is going to happen to those guys, what they would do.
Were there, this might seem like an obvious question, because it's, but let me ask it. Were there missions you saw other planes going, other B-17s going down?
Yeah.
On that
Magdeburg mission, I'll never forget, I was just looking out there, and this group that was crossing us, it's the first time I ever saw a direct hit. This hit that B-17, and it completely disappeared. There weren't any pieces, bits, or nothing up there. It's just a ball of fire, and the whole thing was gone. I've never forgotten that.
And it was hit by flak?
It was hit direct hit by gun flak is what it was. And if both the gasoline and maybe even the bombs went up, but whatever it was, it really went.
How did you deal with that kind of thing? Because it could have just as easily have been your airplane.
Or you just say there, I'm glad it was them and not us. It's sort of caustic remark.
And I guess that's the question is, you fly all these missions in a combat situation. Uh-huh. How do you handle the stress?
Well, it gets to be like a business. You do what you can, and after time you learn things like, people talk about flak. Flak is a very unpleasant thing. There's a lot of it. But all of a sudden you realize that unless you can hear that flak and see the flash of the explosion, it really isn't going to do you too much damage. And all of a sudden, instead of being scared of all this smoke and fire, the only thing you're looking for is the things I'm saying. If you can hear this explosion and see the flash, then you can start worrying. There's a good chance they might hit you then.
Was your plane ever hit by flak?
Oh, God, yes.
How would you know?
Well, in one case, over Hamburg, I was looking up in the Astrodome here, and it got hit by a piece of flak. And when I turned around, the same shell had crazed the pilot's window. He had no visibility out of his window from that same explosion. Three or four other pieces came in. One of them hit me in the shoulder. Just felt like somebody punched you. Nothing awful to it, but there was a lot of it.
Were you at some point doing a countdown on your number of missions you flew?
I suppose so. I don't know whether it was an obsession. I think early on, these poor guys had 25 bad ones to do. It probably was a little tougher in those days.
Did anybody on your crew have any superstitions, a lucky rabbit's foot, anything anything of that sort?
I don't think so. Mm.
Do you remember your last mission?
Yeah.
What do you remember about it?
Well, I remembered. I thought it was pretty stupid because the last mission we flew was the paratroop invasion of Holland in mid-September. And being a navigator, you looked at the situation. I realized there was only one road up to that thing, and it was a pretty, from a military standpoint, a pretty stupid mission in my idea. Here, all of this armor and all of everything has to move up on that one road. And I always thought that the British really blew it on that mission. It was a military disaster. Didn't do anything bad to us. We dropped any bombs on the aircraft emplacements and things up there and went home. But it was a bad military mission. You know, if war is like a game, you like to win all the time at it.
When you flew that last mission, what did it feel like to finish?
Oh, it just sort of felt, well, it's all over. You were relieved, really. You were. Because the easiest mission in the world carries some element of risk. You know, the airplane crash at the end of the runway, blow up anything. It doesn't necessarily have to be enemy action that can do you in.
What happened after that? After your last mission, did you go home immediately, or did you
pretty much so? They sent us up to a sort of a pooling area they had for people who finished their tours. We stayed up there maybe about 5-6 days, and then they shipped us down to Southampton and put us on a ship coming back. The voyage on the ship was pretty nice. The food was good. Waiters, linen tablecloths, all the joys of cruising.
Do you remember which ship it was?
Yeah, it was a sister ship of a ship called the Morro Castle. You may never have remembered the Morro Castle, but it was a cruise liner that ran aground off Asbury Park, New Jersey, back in the 30s somewhere. So it was a pretty comfortable pretty comfortable ship. But you always kept thinking it's 12 days at sea, you could fly the darn ocean in half a day or something like that. It was tedious.
What did it feel like to get back in the U.S.?
Well, that was kind of strange, but you can back and visit your friends and relatives, but then you wonder what they're going to do with you in the meantime. And I got sent to Petersburg, Richmond, Virginia, and then got sent to Ellington Field, and then I had an opportunity to get in the Air Transport Command Ferry Division, so I took that. I went up to St. Joe, Missouri, and made a few foreign trips with airplanes and back to outside of Detroit, and then I wound up on the West Coast at Fairfield Air Base out there flying. It was just a regular airline or what it was. And that was the end of my career.
You remember when you were discharged?
Mm-hmm.
When was that?
The 28th of December, 1944. No, 45, I'm sorry. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Were you tempted to stay in the service?
Not really. There were moments, but it seemed to me that the Army didn't have the faintest idea of what they wanted to do with anyone. And the job that I had flying with the Transport Commission was just like running an airline. And the only thing at that moment we thought, if we kept on, they might shove us up to Okinawa and you might spend 60, 90 days doing nothing but flying from Okinawa to Japan at that point. And that didn't seem like a very... And I wanted to get back to school anyhow. And see.
What kind of work did you end up doing after the war?
I started in sales work after the war. And kind of funny, I majored in accounting in college, but as I mentioned before, when I was just a kid in the accounting department, I never worked so hard in all my life. I thought, you know, payrolls, all these kinds of things that absolutely must be done on a certain day. So I thought, I think my sales and marketing was more appealing than all that deadline stuff. So that.
When you, in your World War II experience, when you look back, are you proud of your time in service?
Yes, I think so, personally.
And tell us why.
Well, it was... it's sort of the biggest thing you'll ever do in your life, really. Winning a war is better than getting a job or a lot of other things, in my opinion. It was quite a test.
Do you feel like a member of the greatest generation?
Yes, I do. I really do. I look around, lots of people of my own age now are retired, and I think collectively that these people have done an awful lot. Most of them are like myself, who went through college on the GI Bill, and we've paid our taxes and paid our dues. I think the country got its money's worth out of us.